What it is, Dan the Schrabwriter. How you doing? We've got too much show for you tonight. You guys are not ready for what's about to go down. Live from the Dan the Schrabwriter downtown Los Angeles, Harmontown is now in session. Spencer Crittenden. Our musical guest, two-time Grammy nominee, Robbie Fulks. Come on out, Robbie.
Oh, shit. Oh, damn. Maybe the one by two.
Any way you like, Rob. Let's bring out the mayor of Harmontown, Mr. Dan Harmon.
Change that curtain.
Yeah, the curtains are different.
Curtain changer.
It's curtains.
Fire that curtain changer. Or rehire them. Change it back. I like my curtains. I like my curtains. Oh.
Damn.
Wait, I have no thingy for my iPhone here.
You have a thingy, it's just the wrong thingy.
Fuck it, we're gonna rely on Zach. Zach, whenever we need a beat, I'm gonna give you the finger and we're gonna go. Huh? The little adapter thingy. Oh. All right. Steve Levy, everybody, Steve Levy.
Steve Levy.
I see.
How are you feeling, Dan?
I'm feeling good.
I'm looking at your face.
Well, I'm kind of like...
Constipated?
No, I just don't know. Jeff's kind of a wild card, and I'm like, he's like, I can't plug my phone in. I'm like, is it upside down? What's happening?
Yeah.
I only have two things I'm excited about. The Pretzel Bacon King. And the new phenomenon that is... the Pretzel Bacon King, whatever. You get the idea. It's a goddamn Burger King burger that's okay. Like on the pretzel bun. I want to rob a bank. I don't have to, but
I don't eat fast food, but that thing looks really good.
God damn it. Pretzel bun, like, first of all, big pretzel bun guy. Is there anybody who's like anti-pretzel bun? Like if you're on a plane and they come by with the basket and they're like, what kind of bun do you want? And there's a pretzel bun in there. Is anybody like, first of all, fuck that shit.
Rob Schrab, everybody!
I have a gluten allergy.
Oh.
But, so I can't eat pretzel bread, but I
or miss any it. Bread.
Do you actually have a gluten allergy,
yeah,
though?
Yeah, I'm celiac.
Oh, shit. When did that happen?
Like, apparently, like, when I was born, I guess. I don't know. How's that working out? For me, not good. I hate it because apparently
doing his own Tyler Durden dialogue. I can't.
But I miss it. But pretzel bread is the shit.
Yeah,
man.
It's great. So,
but I'm
and this
saying,
has bacon.
Saying for the first time in my life, I'm jealous of you. Can I put my phone here? So I don't...
Yeah, you can sit here if you want.
No, I just want. You didn't invite me out. I'm sitting behind the curtain like an idiot.
I was saving you.
Like a piece of shit.
I was saving you. We got. I told the audience we got too much show. We got Robbie. Robbie, how you doing, Robbie?
I'm real good.
You have a mic. No, there's mics everywhere.
Yeah, I'm doing good, thanks.
All right, good to see you. All right, we're all checked in.
The only other thing I'm excited about is just the growing phenomenon of the people tweeting videos of guys sleeping in their Teslas on the freeway.
What?
Everybody keeps driving by, and these guys are just like nodded off behind their wheel of their Tesla. And what I love about it is like it's like, well, that's amazing. Like, I don't blame those people for taking the video. I don't blame them for posting it. They're like, here's something you don't see every day. Sign of the times. This fucking dude is just asleep in his car on the freeway. What I find amazing is like you go down the rabbit hole of the response that it evokes, and it's hilarious to me that it's like, you have to have a war over whether this sleepy Tesla guy is a sign of... It's everything is zero sum. Like, so the first people will be like, oh, real great. Yeah, just what we need. Like, more fucking bullshit on the freeway. And then other people will be like, I don't know. Looks like a pretty good fucking beta test to me.
Damn.
And they're like, beta test? You fucking what if there was a baby on the freeway? Think the car might stop. Maybe wake him up. What the fuck did you do today? And people just go to war. They're going to war over a fucking blender. Like, it's just like you can't find middle ground here. The march of time ain't gonna stop. Car's gonna drive.
Car's gonna drive.
The guy shouldn't be asleep. The guy should not be asleep behind the wheel. I'm gonna tell you, as a Tesla owner, I have spent the amount of time I am willing to be behind the wheel with my eyes closed has spiked dramatically. The reason is because formerly, knowing that you're in a car that will absolutely stop sooner than your foot would stop if anything in front of it. Jesus fucking Christ.
Yes?
Guys, please welcome our guest for tonight. Well, Robbie Fulks is here. He's going to... He's also our guest for tonight.
Do you want him to... Should he play? Because...
Well, I don't... No, I think...
Wait, I don't want to put Robbie on the spot, but what? Instead of me playing one of my stupid little like clips of music, do you want to play our guest on, Robbie? Like kind of like...
Whoa.
Yeah.
Yeah, hang on a second.
Maybe Dan's boom mic for your guitar?
This will probably pick it up.
Dan, give him your boom.
Dan, give him your boom.
Give him your boom.
Ladies and gentlemen, we are about to meet the person who created the only show that's better than anything I've ever done.
Oh, man.
He's both a mentor and a friend and a enemy.
Whoa.
I just threw that in because it seems more Spanish. Please welcome Mitch Hurwitz!
Mitch Hurwitz! Hello, Mitch.
It's freshly rubbed. Sorry, I was back there waiting for Rob's introduction. So
yeah, like that ever gonna happen?
Yeah, what a bummer it is that he got short shrift, huh?
No.
I'm just ruining.
It's so
this
sad thing. When Rob doesn't get what's I due know. Him on this show. But thanks for coming, Emmy winner Mitch.
No, please, come on.
Don't you dare.
Did I wreck it?
No. Oh, is this the one you dropped? No. Hey, did you get the bread basket that we sent over? The I was listening.
No Lisa, fair here's, listening.
Here's
no
what's
fair.
Wrong with the pretzel bread. Can I? I'm yeah. going to say yeah. something a little controversial, and you know, it's a difficult time now to go out on a limb like this. But it can be dry, right? You can have a pretzel like a bun on a burger, and it can be too dry.
Okay.
Wow. Shots fired.
All right.
I've never experienced a pretzel bun too dry. They're normally buttery and soft.
Well, I don't know. You know, maybe I'm on the private flights and they don't give you the good ones or something. I don't.
Oh, shit. See, wait, why is your Arrested Development private airline giving you dry pretzel bread?
Well, it was a bad investment. No. It was a fucked up. And I kind of thought the show's going to go forever. And, and you know, it's like I'm starting a streaming network, and now it's like another bad investment. It's like, of all times, to
you
start
know.
A streaming
network. You've been
working
network. At Netflix all this time, and then you went and started a streaming
I
network?
I wanted to start, well, because they've had such great luck with it,
right.
And I thought, you know, and then I thought, you know, what's not out there? And I thought, well, like, there's too much content.
Right.
So there's not a lot of content.
Okay. Now I'm following, yeah.
And it's got two tiers.
Oh.
Yeah, it's good. Like advertising is $4 a month.
Okay.
And then like more advertising is like $6 a month.
That sounds like our business model.
Yeah, it's good.
Which is why we're ending the show soon.
Yeah, because it doesn't make any sense.
Yeah, we'd love to have you do nothing on it at some point. Because we're not into content. That's not our... That's not our thing.
What have you generated over at Netflix? Did they give you like an overall deal? I was real jealous.
I did have an overall deal. There wasn't much to be jealous about. I mean, it was nice to be able to use the pool whenever I wanted.
Right, the Netflix pool.
That was good.
I feel like the shape just seems to not... I get it. It has to be an N, but
yeah.
That doesn't help with swimming.
Yeah. No, it was great. They do a lot of things. Their spa is great, and their restaurants obviously are worth it. But I did a couple of things over there, and then I spent a lot of time bringing back Arrested Development and then ruining that decision. But I won't get into that.
Why did you ruin that decision?
No, I didn't.
He won't get into it.
I won't get into it.
He won't
nobody
get into it.
Nobody looks good in this story.
Mitch, nobody's listening to this. Just tell us why you ruined that decision. The show is dying. Nobody cares.
No one's been fired for things that happened here before.
We're getting canceled.
We're
getting canceled.
Yeah, and you were going to announce your comeback tour, right? Isn't that tonight you're going to...
Yeah, I think...
Excuse me, what? Sorry. What? 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 You got... What?
Hey, I all got you. Three Suzannes and an Emmy.
Awesome. Okay, anyway, continue with the podcast.
Three Suzannes.
Oh, shit.
And an Emmy.
Oh.
How come everybody has a little spot for their drink?
You can have this table or... Yeah, I feel bad for you. Have you met Grammy
Jeff's
winning
doing something.
Singer-songwriter?
Oh, no.
Did you win a Grammy? Oh, look at that.
We have a distinct...
That's is that so low
nice.
Enough?
That's so nice.
Dude, you want
get a higher chair?
Yeah, we can put it on the floor if you want.
Hey, Robbie, Mitch, are you a singer at all? Do you like to sing music?
Are you kidding me?
I smell a segue.
That's my first love, is singing music.
Is it really?
Yes. No, I don't. I don't sing, but I will if that would be.
No, I mean, I just don't want to waste our Robbie Fulks on the crowd here now.
Oh well, no. You want to play something, and I'll just scat.
Yeah.
No, I wouldn't dare.
Wait, no, Dan.
I wouldn't dare.
Dan, there you go.
Well, I don't want to appropriate the scat from the people who gave it to us, not the people, but you know what I mean. Let's put it up.
That's easy.
That's your next Grammy.
It is that easy.
That's your next Grammy.
Wow.
That was great.
I've never heard woke scat before.
No, it's really...
woke scat. Post-appropriate.
That's a great name for a scat
woke
singer.
Scat.
Woke scat.
I got no right to make a sound that isn't very restrained and coming through a sphincter of privilege. To pretend.
Hey, let's enjoy white privilege while we have it.
That's the thing. I don't understand why white people get so
upset
about it.
We haven't been enjoying our privilege enough.
We've been privileged, we just haven't enjoyed it.
The white privilege.
Here's the thing that white people don't understand. When you're told that you have privilege, you're socialized to understand that precedes shit getting taken from you.
Right.
But
yeah.
Society doesn't work by those rules. Like, people can just say, "Hey, you've got privilege," and you can be like, "Thanks," and you don't have to do shit.
Well, you don't even have to thank them.
Actually, yeah.
I was driving next to a cop over here for a while, and I noticed. First I noticed I was trying to be a very good citizen. You know that thing where the cop is next to you and you're just trying to show that you're no, go ahead. No, I would let this guy go.
Yeah.
I'm not. Like, why? You're going to be an asshole.
I'm not shoplifting.
And then I really did think, like no, fuck it. You know, this is a good opportunity for white privilege. Like, let me be a little bit of an asshole and see what happens. And, you know, so I pretended I was on the phone just saying, like, are you fucking kidding me? Look over to the cop. That part's not true, but I really did. But I really did notice. Like, why am I my best behavior here?
Yeah, everything you're reading is
I once told a cop to go fuck himself, and I like that's if that's not white privilege, then nothing is.
Uh-huh. Yeah,
yeah. Yeah. I one time picked up. I was walking my dog, and in our neighborhood, the police have. Excuse me.
That's how it works. This is the aftershocks.
This is the blowback.
No, the guy got a nickel put in him, so he's going to keep doing that until eventually he pukes and falls over, and then it's like...
No. Go on.
If you can find it within you, just please shut up. it, no matter how much that tempts you to keep talking, like you gotta, you're in a different zone than the rest of us. There's like a bunch of people that pay money to be at the show.
This is the Andrew Yang rally where everybody just screams their heads off. Like it's the Roman Coliseum.
I should probably take care of it. Right?
Go on, Rob. I told a rando with nothing to contribute that he shouldn't talk. So now make this count.
Okay. So I'm walking my dog in our neighborhood. The police have been killing civilians. Okay.
Right.
I'm walking the dog, and you know, it's like sometimes when they bring out like. The garbage, you know, it's sitting there and you're walking the dog and you get the bag of shit and you're like, oh, bonus, I don't have to turn the corner, I can just put it right there, you know, and I'm walking and I miss it, and then I go, oh, I should turn around and throw the dog shit away. And as I was turning around and putting my arm up, a police car with the window open drove by at the same time. So it looked like, and forgive me for people who don't have the visual of this. So it looks like me like going, like if you're the cop, I'm like, like this.
Oh my God.
So it just, cause it just, I was walking this way and then I do a sharp turn with my hand up with a bag. And you know, in our neighborhood, somebody had a towel in his hand and got his face blown off.
Yeah, you get shot through the
eye. You
gotta
turn that into like a Blue Lives Matter.
Yes.
Just, you know, he's right there.
And the cop like went like this.
Oh,
like
Jesus.
Reacted,
oh, no.
And I went, oh my. Life. Oh my God, I could have been killed right
you
there.
You could have been killed.
That's basically what happened to that guy.
Right. Totally the same thing.
God damn it, sir. It's like...
Front row.
Raise your hand. Who's the guy? Raise your hand.
He can't.
Okay,
he raises his hand. Yeah, but leg is going to go up.
But stop it. I'll come over there and kung fu you. I'll fucking...
I don't think his leg is going to go up. No, I know. Look, I know you guys don't get along. But I don't think... that his brain controls his arm and his leg at the same time.
Well, I'm just thinking, it's like the Three Stooges when they're plumbers, you know, like if you flush the toilet, the shower goes. Isn't that why if you were in an audience and you're not supposed to talk, you'd be like, I'm talking.
I mean, it's possible.
It's that thing that people, like, now that our show is dying and we're going to be done soon, I think people just want to be Adam Goldberg for like the at the buzzer.
But
like,
not,
like,
but
what if I can be like the last person that the whole crowd hated, and we all learn that person's name?
Wasn't the case, it's certainly going to be the case now.
Yeah,
I don't think that guy fits in that category.
No,
though,
I think
he's not
drunk.
He's not going. I work in data processing. He's going like volume up. Change the channel. Discovery. Like, he's not here Born right up. Now. He belongs home,
He's got a backpack full of explosives. We're all going to die.
Well, I think we're the...
We're not all going to die. Most of us are going to die.
That's really smart. Otherwise, that's against the law. You can't say, we're all going to die.
Yeah.
You know, there's explosives.
Legally, I can only say that some of us are going to die.
Yeah, you could say, there's a small fire. And, you know, and then some people would leave. But you can't say there's a...
You can't say there's a fire. Yeah. That's what's gonna happen every 4 minutes. It's gonna get like.
Oh,
it's
he's
like,
doing great. He's,
I all right. Think we got, why are you on his side? Why are you on his side?
Here's the thing, too. This is the scariest part about it. I forgot my wallet.
You think he's got it?
No. When I almost got shot by the police, the first thing I thought of was like, I forgot my wallet in the house because I'm just going, you know, I'm running out with the dog to take a shit. I don't need fucking ID to tell the grass it's my dog shit.
But now suddenly you're in a situation where you got to prove to this guy, no, this is my dog shit.
Wait.
Which is a very hard thing.
I was going to go, they would shoot me, I would be dead, and it would be hours before Kate would even know, even though I'm right outside the house.
Right. Michael Stipe killed in Koreatown.
There you go. Oh, boy.
No.
Countdown to Moby in 5, 4, 3.
Or Moby,
2,
for that matter.
Yes,
it looks a little bit like Moby. Did the cops, was there any kerfuffle? Like,
no one ever says Statham, ever. Come on. Way more timely. I'll take the glasses off. Just once.
Statham.
Hey, Robbie Fulks. Have you moved permanently to Los Angeles, or are you still a Chicago denizen?
We're over in Silver Lake, Jeff.
Silver Lake.
Yeah. I'm trying to figure out how I got here. We were just drinking in the drawing room.
Yeah, and I dragged you over here.
And now we're here, yeah.
Whoa. You may have fallen asleep in your Tesla.
Yeah, that thing will drive you over.
Do you live here for good, or are you guys just still beta testing? You and Donna still living out here?
I think we're here for good. Yeah, we're in a temporary place, but I think we like it here. It's nice and everything. It's nice.
Would you be willing to give us a little more music and we'll
for scatting or
yeah,
for
or, well you know or
should he have your boom mic or do we have another one? Why don't you trade mics?
He's got
Dan?
His mic in between his legs.
He's got this great technique.
Like, you're obsessed with booming
it's
him.
Genius. But he has to sing too.
Oh, he has to sing. Okay.
Yeah. So like let's make this work, you guys.
Got this, Daniel.
Now, for those of you that don't know Robbie, and I'm gonna pimp him out right now. He is one of my favorite musicians of all time, and I know him through Dino Stamatopoulos, our friend. You're from where in the South, Robbie?
North Carolina.
North Carolina. This guy, I'm gonna fucking punch him. And
somewhere in the South. I can't. That's where he's at. He's
I will remove you, sir, if you keep doing that. But you've lived in Chicago for some good time, right?
Yeah, real long time in Chicago, and yeah.
What am I
doing? A song? Is that what I'm doing?
Well, yeah. Now you're being interviewed. Okay.
Yeah.
Can I sing one with you?
Huh?
You want to start with a Robbie Fulks original, or should we sing one together?
Oh, we can do one together. Yeah. What do you want to do? That Everly song we were singing at the drawing room.
Okay. Yeah. All right. Let's try that.
All right.
I'll do my best, but I'll do the melody, and you do the high Everly.
I'll give it a shot.
We used to have good times together, but now I feel them slip away. It makes me cry to see love die. So sad to watch good love go bad. Remember how it used to feel, dear.
Feel.
You said nothing could change your mind. It breaks my heart to see us part. So sad to watch good love go bad.
Take the bridge.
Yo. Girl, I remember all the times back in the day, you used to fuck around. And it breaks my heart, girl. Don't be like that.
It breaks my heart. You used to feel dear. You said nothing could change your mind.
I'm all fucked up now. All right.
Cop killer.
It breaks my heart to see love's part.
Slinging rock.
So sad. So to sad watch to see good love go bad.
Special Victims Unit.
So sad to watch good love go bad.
Who expected? Who expected Ice-T to? Here, Mitch, take your mic back.
Featuring Ice-T
to the victims. I
didn't know Ice-T was in the house tonight.
I did not expect Ice-T to come into that song.
That was beautiful, except for the Special Victims Unit part.
Well, he doesn't. Yeah, he doesn't have a right to plug that.
Yeah, no, that's right.
Like they don't. Yeah.
Yeah.
No. Yeah, but he doesn't care about rules. For him, it's not business.
It's about business, isn't it?
Oh well, I think he's changed lately.
Whoa.
I think he's decided that now it's personal.
Let's bring out Ice-T, everybody. How you doing, Ice-T? I hear that you have been busy on a couple shows? Or?
Yeah. But I got shrunk down. I'm baby T.
You're lowercase T?
I'm a little tiny, little lowercase T. They can't all be gems.
You just went uppercase T on that one, though. Like.
All right. It's just me.
It's just, okay. Are you workshopping some new teas,
yeah.
Ice-T?
I'm trying to get out of a contract with Sony. You know they invented HDMI just to put digital copyright inside your cords? That ain't personal. That's business. Ain't nothing an HDMI cord does except prevent you from recording Beatles songs.
I see. I didn't realize that you were this active on.
I've been learning.
A consumer advocate.
I've been learning about cables.
Yeah.
I've been crimping my own RG59 coax. SDI 3G 6G. Damn. I can make Ethernet 5E, Cat 6, Cat 6A, 10 gigabits per second.
10 gigabytes per
bits,
second?
10 gigabits.
Okay.
All right? Shit. That shit goes through your walls. It won't degrade. Fuck.
You seem like you're kind of in a bad mood about this.
You lay 1,000 feet of Cat 6A cable through the walls of your new hacienda? You're data ready for 10 years, bitch.
All right.
Future proof.
Okay, you don't have to get personal and ad hominem about it.
It's not personal.
It's business?
It's data. which is the future of business.
Oh, shit. It's not business anymore.
The internet's going to change everything. And every home's going to be its own internet. I want to be able to be located in my living room and sell shit to someone from India that's in my bedroom. Buy capitalism. I mean, hello too, but...
It sounds like the definition of capitalism.
But through wires now. Fuck that. I mean, fuck it, good. Something.
Are you still into music? Are you still recording?
Hell yeah. Me and Body Count, we're doing it hardcore.
Oh, yeah?
It's not about
I heard you have a new track for us that is kind of more of a country tip.
Yeah.
Kind of a bluegrass kind of feel.
I mean, if you don't think that's a double beat, yeah.
No, but this is more of a bluegrass thing, which is, people don't think that's your wheelhouse. But
sure.
Yeah. What's this one called?
The Road to T. Well, I've been personal all my life. And I've been eating peas with a knife. I've had spoons and forks in my jeans. But I don't know if you know what I mean. It ain't personal, it's business. It ain't what it seems. It ain't personal, it's business. Down from my shoes, up into the crap in my inseam.
Wow, Mr. T, that's very good. Mr. T.
I don't know about measures and kind of.
It sounds like your band kind of waited for you to find it.
Yeah, I appreciate that. Thank you, Robbie, for trying to wait for me and figure it out, but your big mistake was I ain't gonna figure it out. I'm a wanderer, you know? I'm just like looking at your fingers being like, damn, let's do this. All right, come on. All right, that's enough. Look, it's an elevator coming down. Bye, Ice-T.
You started to
cross a threshold. Bye.
It was good.
You can't do that for too long.
He just kind of like Irish exited. He just boned out. Yeah. But it was great to have Ice-T on the show.
No, it's great. It's always great.
I think he knew more about measurement than he was leading on. You know, because I think, inseam, that matters. That's everything in a man's pant.
Yeah.
You know. which I think is what it was getting.
Why is it in the movies they're always like the inseam is like an allusion to like your dick being big? Is that a real thing? Like, what is the inseam?
No, it's just that when they measure you up, the tape measure goes from your ankle up to your crotch.
And your dick size doesn't change your inseam, right?
No, it shouldn't.
Right.
It shouldn't, yeah. Has yours changed recently?
No.
Okay, then you're fine.
I'd say in the movies, they're always like, the inseam.
Because
like,
there is a kind of swollen crotch, which is not a good thing. And you want to be sure you don't have that.
Right.
Yeah, you'll need some of that powder.
In movies, it's always like the these horny Italian tailors.
Yeah. Checking out your shit.
Yeah.
Checking out your crotch.
You should do a show called Checking Out Your Crotch, but it'd be like Schitt's Creek, and like Crotch would be the name of the town. Because that's very popular now.
Do you still want to do stuff, Mitch?
Sure. Yeah, I do.
I don't.
I do. Really?
Yeah,
I'll do some of your stuff.
Oh, go ahead. Yeah. Do you want you want some of my ideas?
Do you have any like Schitt's Creek type things?
I have like what do I have? Like what
I was going to do a show called Motherfuckers, which is this woman who they call the Mother, and her last name is Fuckers.
Oh.
And so she's the Motherfuckers.
Oh, that's cool.
And that way you can say it on TV and stuff, and, you know.
I have like 5 ideas that are Groundhog Day meets something.
Yeah. I know.
Is that okay?
I'm doing Russian Doll meets Groundhog Day.
Oh,
so
shit.
I don't know. Maybe it's too close.
Do you watch anything? I hate it when people ask me this, but only because the answer is kind of always embarrassingly no, but I have been watching Succession lately.
Oh my God.
Do you like Succession?
Yeah, and you know why? Succession is brilliant. I mean, if you haven't discovered Succession yet, you have
I
to.
Haven't.
And I went into it a little bit like defensive.
Very jaded.
Because it was, I had been told, you know, it's kind of like the characters, there's even like a Tobias, there's like 4 kids and all this stuff, and so I kind of went.
It is very Bluthy, yeah.
Yeah, and
it's
then
like,
I saw
it's like
it was
Arrested
like,
Development, the drama in its conceit, yeah.
But it's so much funnier than Arrested Development. I mean, it won on every point, and now I'm just a fan. I'm a complete
fan. There's no
fan
competition, obviously, yeah, but I can see how people would be, like, tweeting you and going, like, hey, I liked it better when it was this. You know, like, I get that.
But no, it's inspired, and I even like the thing at the end where the author, you know, I haven't done one of those shows where at the end you get to talk about the scenes.
Oh,
you know,
like
at the end of like Game of Thrones.
Oh, I never watched.
It's like
those.
You get absorbed in the story, and then someone says, "You know, when we wrote that scene with the dragon, you're like, fuck, none of it happened."
Yeah, I
know. You know what I mean? Like,
I don't watch those. I can't imagine people watching those.
Yeah, no, it's it kind of takes the fun out of it.
Yeah, because it's like, there's Arya Stark, but she's like drinking a Diet Coke, and she's like, Governor.
She didn't want to do that scene. she didn't want to kiss him.
She's like, here's the 3 takes where I like jumped in the air with the knife, but then I landed on a cat. Like, what? This is awful. Why are you doing this to me? Yeah. I thought you were real. I thought there was an actual Game of Thrones.
It's like the networks are saying, well, we're all adults, right? I mean, we all know this is bullshit.
Yeah, fuck this shit. Yeah, who's bored? Raise your hand.
We all know this was just a bunch of Jews writing in a room. I mean, who are we?
You know who the real heroes are? The fucking ugly people that had to write this shit. That's a Game of Thrones. You want to meet a fucking dragon? Meet Benjamin, the writer's PA. He's a fucking hairy character.
I just want to do one of those, and I want to like really seriously talk about the show. It's just like the most ridiculous show, and then just say, well, it's really about loss. We were getting at. We wanted to explore loss, and that's why we had his penis showing when he bent over like that.
The performances, the casting in Succession are great, and it really is like Cody was watching it just for her own purposes, and so that's the only way I'm ever gonna get like hooked into a show because I'm so lazy, and I've talked endlessly about like I don't know what it is that keeps me away from watching shit, but. It's like Cody's got the laptop open. It starts with me hearing dialogue, and I'm so jaded. I'm like, was that supposed to be funny? I don't know. What is it, a dramedy or a tragicomedy? Like whatever. Pick a lane. I'm just sort of like I just have this jaded like membrane, and then gradually things will land, and I'll be like, well, what's going on over there? Yeah, is that a musical montage or what's happening
with those housewives, and why won't he?
Why are they desperate?
Won't he show up on time to the party?
And then you just get drawn in.
What the fuck?
And Cody made fun of me because I was like, this show's boring at one point. I almost don't want to say that out loud because it makes me sound like such a fucking douche. But I was like, but it is, that's how good the show is because it was probably like a couple hours later when I'm like, I got work to do. And I was like, come on, what's the next episode? And she's like, oh, the boring show? And I'm like, all right, you got, yeah, it fucking yeah. like, it's riveting. I don't know. Yeah, it's
riveting. It doesn't go where you expect it to go. The characters are more nuanced than you think.
Predictable enough
yep.
to actually be. That's what I really like about it is yeah. that it doesn't try to purposely. It doesn't engage in like hot rod unpredictability. It actually gives you perfect. This guy's a junkie. He's gonna do what fucking junkies do, and yep. you know how that's gonna end up the way you think it is.
Yeah.
But it's like the details are. Are lateral enough that there's a confidence in the
there is that thing that we don't often get to do in comedy where you leave some things unexplained. You know, in comedy it's all about you explain everything. You want everybody to get every joke. And that
yeah, he's just
I feel like Rob left.
He's getting to that age. That's like he has to go every 30
I think
minutes.
That's why it's wise that you didn't introduce him because Because what for?
Yeah.
get used to
but anyway, yeah, they get to, you get to like look into the character's eyes. You know, is she upset? What is she? Is she relieved? It's spectacular.
Yeah, it's good. You kind of love. I felt that way about Game of Thrones too. I like good dramas that are like serialized because you get to pick a character and you go like that person's the best. All these other people annoy me, and then you're like. Okay, well, that person I also understand, and it yeah. kind of settles in like Velcro, and you're like yeah. slowly, and they're just like, I love all these fucking assholes,
yeah.
and like you kind of like you're watching a soap opera, and it's great.
I always wanted to do a show. I did a show actually, did four episodes of a show called Everything's Relative, and the conceit, which NBC didn't quite let me do, was going to be that every episode another character basically thinks the show's about them. You know, like they're the normal person,
yeah.
like the Michael Bluth, basically.
Right.
So, it started off with like the white kid who was 35, but then the next episode was like the mom. It was just all the mom's point of view.
Yeah.
And they kind of do that in a way.
We never got to do the project we were going to do together, which I think we could just open source now because I'm retired. But,
no, let's do it.
All right.
Well, I have a way to do it.
But not at Netflix?
No, it doesn't have to be on Netflix.
There's no back end there.
No, I think we should do it on my streaming thing.
What's it called?
My streaming platform could stand a little content.
You don't have a streaming platform.
Do you really? I'm starting a streaming platform. It's got two tiers. I feel like I mentioned this, but...
The cool thing is it's just your last name, so you don't need to make up a Silicon Valley
Google
name.
No, it's not
Hurwitz.
My last name. It's not.
It's called NetMitch.
No, it's Media Master Plus.
That's refreshingly Bruckheimerian.
Yeah. If we're not like violating some sort of
please no. This is all publicity for the league.
What's the name of your show and what's the premise? Like, give me the elevator pitch.
It's not a show. It's a platform.
Okay.
So that's already you're way off.
All right. I thought you guys had a
Media Master Plus.
That show.
Yeah.
That show.
Media Master Plus. The show is a platform.
I'm doing a couple.
Two tiers. You got to get that in there.
Tiers of power.
Power.
that's great. It's getting a little into content, which we're trying to avoid, but I...
Okay. Is there any content, or is it just you talking about the platform?
Well, one of the things I wanted to do is I want to harness people's webcams. And then they're basically, it's almost like a mirror.
They're the show.
That's the show. Like,
yeah.
you see your own life,
right.
But you don't, but it's not flipped like a mirror.
Shit.
And that's the key difference.
It's how people
see
you.
Oh, and they're ads.
Oh.
Yeah. That's two differences.
The
second tier is that you get to watch yourself and there's ads.
Yeah, yeah. Okay. And it's like, you're going to love it.
And you're the first streaming platform that's not content-based.
No content.
No content.
No, I think people are burnt out on content.
It's time that your own self is enough.
Well, I think it is, although we are in a deal with Schitt's Creek, I will be honest. We're trying to go downstream of that a little bit. And then we have something called Head Up Your Asses.
Right.
The Urass family.
Oh, the Urass yeah. family. You can say it on
TV. You can say it on TV because it's their name.
That's crazy.
Those... I mean, honestly, when I was watching the Emmys, they're like, Schitt's Creek. Like, oh my God. You wow. can say Schitt's Creek on the yeah. Emmys? That's fantastic. It is a hilarious show, by the way. I don't mean
it's
to be. It's a dog.
It's.
Wait, what?
Well, it's a dog.
It's a dog.
I'm going to miss this show.
Yeah.
No, I'm not.
But our idea was.
It's multidimensional.
We were going to do, we're going to team up.
We're still going to do it. I have a way to do it. You sure you want to tell them?
But your way to do it is your joke.
No,
that's
not a way. That's not the way to do it. It would not be good for Media Master Plus.
Right.
It's not an MM Plus.
We wouldn't run it on that.
Okay.
It's not an MM Plus.
But I don't want to do it on Netflix because I want back
no,
end.
No, I'm, it wouldn't be on Netflix.
Okay.
Yeah. All I know, right. back end.
What, like CBS All Access?
Back end would be nice.
NBC Purview?
Is CBS, CBS's All Access, ABC like there's no one crackle? They say no to? There's not like some institutional racism or something where it's like, no, you're Korean. You can't get this channel. It's All Access.
Yeah, I think that, yeah, that, I think that's
no,
their,
they
that's
still,
their
they still hate Koreans on that.
They do.
It's like well, CBS, they... but everyone's allowed to watch.
Yeah, well, that's great. That's really yeah. so big of them.
Yeah.
CBS All Access. CBS, everybody can watch. Maybe
white
that'll
people.
Work. Yeah. Maybe that'll. Are you have a deal there? Are you exclusive there?
I'm working with your buddy Ron on a thing yeah, for CBS
Ron Howard.
All Access.
Ron Howard, we had very, very nice job.
You always have to go, I'm working at CBS. And then you pause, and then you go, All Access.
People are so relieved. They're like, oh, my God, finally, bisexuals can watch CBS. You know what I mean? It's not like you don't have to pass any fucking test. Like, anybody's welcome.
I do. I will say, CBS being like, I think that they're playing it the smartest, because I was part of CISO, which was NBC's half-hearted attempt to, like, they're like, oh, we see where this is going. The yep. world's going to be mini Netflixes. And so they put a little bit of money into this thing, CISO, and we created Harmon Quest for them, and a lot
we
of great
sure
shows
did.
Were created for them under the...
You took all of CISO's money, as I heard it. That was the word that got
we
back
took
to
all
us.
Of it.
It was like, no, Dan has all their money.
They
now.
Ran out.
We
rolled a 20.
Okay.
But I think CBS is being the smartest about it, because they're basically, they go like, here's our platform on the web, CBS All Access. All Access is simultaneously like unignorable, but it's also like just sort of like it's just it means nothing. So I think they sat there and went like, well, what are we gonna do? Eventually, the thing with the antennas, no one's gonna watch it anymore, right? And yeah. they're like, so we can't call this thing Snap Crackle Dipple Dabble, like we can't like go all in on that and have it compete with like the right. old world thing. It's just like just call it CBS with a ramp. Call
yeah,
it,
right.
call it CBS All Aboard, and then it's like everyone gets aboard, yeah. and it's like. CBS, psych, burp. Yeah. It's like, welcome
oh,
to CBS.
Oh, just kidding, we're Netflix. Ha, ha, ha.
Yeah, no, it's, I, property
that's,
of
that's
the
right.
Bank.
It's like, yeah. hey, we don't want any trouble. We're just CBS, All Access.
Yeah, like there's nothing. It's not CBS Platinum Plus Shadow Master. Like,
but
it's,
also, the CBS television, they produce for everybody. So you could go.
Exactly.
You could go to.
What is the Hurwitz Harmon project you guys are talking about? You guys.
It wouldn't be for you. I don't think you would appreciate.
You're outside
it.
The demo.
You're
this
outside
is more of a millennial
the demo.
Thing. It's like if you you're a millennial.
It's for millennials
you don't know
like
me.
Us.
Run it by me. Just give me the elevator pitch on your guys' show.
Well, why don't we just
you wouldn't
sing
understand
the...
cuz it's all abbreviations.
Oh,
it's all just initials.
Do you guys already
it's all
have
millennial.
You have an opening theme song.
We have
right?
a theme song. Why don't we just sing the theme song and
I feel like it gives away too much.
I think you'll get the idea. It's like, remember the Beverly Hillbillies, like the whole conceit.
Yeah.
But you're okay.
Yeah, it was like
share.
You would watch the main title and you go like, okay, that's enough. I've had yeah. enough story.
Yeah. Two garbage men found a genie
who worked in sanitation as well as the garbage men.
But the garbage genie had thrown away half of its wishes.
But the two garbage men didn't care because they were happy delivering garbage.
So now the three of them are a family delivering wishes that other people throw away.
The genie is dying. A painful death. that Western medicine can't treat yet. So it's got some heart, too.
But one of the garbage men is withholding his final wish, which he could use to cure the genie, but he wants to fuck her.
That's why.
Family. Delivering garbage and wishes.
Misunderstanding the very concept of what garbage men do. They don't deliver garbage.
Hashtag rape culture. That's not the title.
Millennials only is the title. Yeah.
Yeah.
Partial access. It's on CBS Partial Access.
Partial Access. Yeah. CBS is racially motivated, little known partial access. It's actually just for.
It's on CBS No Audio.
And a lot of great. People go like, oh, is it? It's like Moonraker. It's like the only people that can watch CBS Partial Access. It's like it's selected people from each racial group on Earth. Their logo.
That's what happens in Moonraker. I don't remember that from Moonraker.
It's like a super colony of people. You know, they're like you want like there's like three people of every part of Earth life that CBS is gonna start a super colony with.
You know, we're going to be gene splicing at some point, and we will be able to do that. We will be able to decide what qualities we should have. And you can imagine how badly this will go.
Well, people will be able to say to parents, because, you know, it's like the GI Bill and student loans and things, it's going to go in a direction where people will go like, so you want to have a kid, which, by the way, shame on you. Like,
yeah,
we'll,
really.
We'll be trained to be like, oh, I'm
That's
such a horrible
green.
Person.
Yeah.
And this time and day, like I want to have a kid. And it'll be like, oh, yeah, I want an SUV. And the doctor will sit you down and go, so here's the different packages. This one, if you agree that your kid will be super into anime for 7 years, the Japanese government is willing to give you $10,000 for diapers.
Pretty big carrot.
If your kid has an affinity for Apple products or is willing to work in the stock room, like for 5 years, everything will be their life will be broken.
That's
into
really
like,
interesting.
Like
it'll be a trade-off. Yeah. I think, I also think that if we'd gotten this a while ago, like the mistakes we would have made, we would have probably gotten rid of fear, right? I mean, you think about what people's biggest problems are, usually fear-based. So we would have gotten rid of that. We'd all be dead.
Yeah. That's what you need right now, more fearless people.
Yeah.
Let's see what we can do about that shame, too. Let's dial that shame down a little bit. I encounter too many shameful people on the internet nowadays. You know, I post a picture of my fiance. Why is the 15-year-old that leaves a comment have to be so shame-driven? Come on, kid. Don't be afraid to say whatever the fuck you want to an adult that could beat the piss out of you. Go ahead. Let it rip. After all, your username is a string of fucking dollar signs and a missile emoji. You're too shameful. You like Nazis, Robbie?
Robbie and the Nazis.
Oh, look who's back.
Colonel
Clink.
So glad
you could join us.
Speaking of Nazis.
It's fucking cold up here. Oh. Do you know how freezing it is?
Take a bath? What did you do? Were you?
Oh, I took a pee and then I sat down and I, you know.
We can
like,
do that? We can just go pee?
Yeah, the show's done.
Nothing matters anymore.
Nothing matters.
Rob, weren't you going to do like kind of a soulful solo song about how nothing matters anymore?
Sure.
He doesn't care. Doesn't matter.
Nothing matters when I go take a pee. I don't even flush. When I'm finished, I let it mellow. It smells like spinach. Cause I ate some yesterday. Nothing matters. Nothing matters. My pea smells like spinach. You like it?
Nothing matters.
I don't. I hold my nose when I urinate.
Yes. That's where it pays off
Thank
to
you.
Have them.
Thank you. Thank you.
That's what we've been waiting for.
I came back on stage because I needed some help. And luckily that was completely off mic.
Right.
And the paying customers won't hear it.
Robbie, well, we did a gig in New York together with Dino and Stephen Colbert and Louis C.K. and Tina Fey and a bunch of people's. And everybody was freaked out that you were there because they
I was even more uncomfortable on that stage than I am on this one.
Tina before the show, she's like, and I'd never met I met Tina once, but I'd never met Stephen Colbert, and they're like, Robbie Fulks is going to be here, and they were nervous about being on a stage with you, like because they
I don't think that's true what you're saying.
No, it is true. Because, I mean, it's true because I heard them say that, and Tina said that she used to get guitar lessons from you back in the Chicago Second City days, and they all took lessons from you because it was like getting a free Robbie Fulks concert.
Wow.
They didn't want to learn?
Nice.
Does that piss you off?
It was frustrating, yes.
Like, I would have charged more.
Wait, Tina sniffs out a deal. I'll tell you, something else.
She knows a deal when she sees one.
Yeah, like, how much?
What was the song you and Tina sang? Because you did a duet together. Was it like a Johnny and a June song? Or?
Oh, gosh, I'm trying to remember. I think it might have been Success by Loretta Lynn.
Okay, yeah, that was it.
Yeah.
And she can really sing.
Yeah, she's a good singer, right?
Yeah, you guys were fantastic together. But she told me before the show, and I only met her briefly once, and she's like, I'm having a fucking freak out right now because I have to go up on stage and sing with Robbie Fulks. Wow.
You know, I did I don't know if this story's of interest or not. She had a birthday party one time. She was turning 40, and she asked me to, or no, she didn't. Her husband asked me to, Jeff asked me to come play, and it was a surprise for her. And so what's the story here? Well, one story is that I thought, I didn't know what it would be like, right? It's in a rock club, and I didn't know, would it be like her parents, or would it be comedians, or what would it be? And it was basically...
It's just Rob Schneider sitting in a rocking
chair. Right. Rob Schneider was there, and Melanie Hutzel, they were all there. So that's a joke for three people, but... no, it's like an office party, basically a 30 Rock office. Like the cast and the producers and stuff were there. There were like 40 people there, you know, in a club that holds 600 people, and they were milling around. And Tina sat on a couch, kind of in the middle, and watched me play, and everybody else ignored me. And I was with like a 7-piece band, making a lot of noise, and I prepared some special material, and. I think this is mildly interesting. I've never told this story before, but I thought, I was preparing this stuff, and I thought it was too complimentary of Tina. I wrote a song about Tina and about our old days in Chicago and this and that, and was feeling really kind of corny and positive. And I'm 2 minutes into this song, and I thought, well, I'll do a joke in here. So the song was a... Da 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 da. Tina, whoa 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 whoa, Tina. Anyway, I put in a line about Tina, you're faultless in my book. Then I go, date night, I'll overlook, like that. Date Night was a terrible movie that she was in. Just to explain
right.
that.
Right.
And so I got to this joke, and the crowd was kind of like enjoying it up to that point. Like it was about Tina, uh-oh, and it was positive, and then. It just turned the whole mood of the room, really turned on
because
that.
they probably all worked on the film.
Yeah.
It was a total miscalculation. It was a total miscalculation. And I apologized to her afterwards because I thought I'd kind of ruined a moment. And she said, oh, no, she said, I expected you to insult me because it's you. She said, they're just all scared of me, she said.
She's kind of intense. I my brief encounters with her, like, she really is like to meet her is to have been met pretty hard.
That's great.
But like, she told me, she was, "You're Jeff. You. You're a funny motherfucker."
And then
she turned around and walked away. That's meeting Tina for me. So nice. She just nails you and then fucking bones out.
You didn't even get a chance to just kick her in the balls over the date night thing. Just go right after.
That sounds amazing.
It does, actually. I would think, it must be harder, well, maybe it's not, but is it harder to play for a small audience than a large audience?
An audience of one.
Yeah, I mean, an audience of one, too. Yeah, that's kind of daunting.
I don't know what it's like to play for a large audience. Maybe it is harder.
The first time I saw you, I was in Chicago, and I asked Dino, like, what's something cool to do in Chicago? And he goes, you should go, is it The Hideout or The Hideaway?
The Hideout.
The Hideout, what part of town in Chicago is that called?
It doesn't really have a name, but it's on the near north side. It's
like
kind of
Bucktown,
like,
or
no, it doesn't even have a name.
Okay, it's just it's by a.
Is it Jamestown?
Three more guesses.
LoHo.
All I know is
LoHo? Castle Rock.
It was by a rubbish tip and some debris.
And that is correct.
Yeah, and I went in there and saw the show, and I texted my brother Bill, and I was like, dude, like you would fucking freak out right now. There's this guy named Robbie Fulks playing. He's playing like bluegrass, country, folky stuff. And I texted my brother, and he texted back, and he goes, "I have every one of his records." And I met you after the show. I said, "I know Dino Stamatopoulos. My brother is on the phone right now." And you got on the phone, and you insulted me to my brother. You said, "I like you more than your brother. Your brother's a piece of shit."
So I said you were terrible on date night, I remember.
you got one go-to. It was like,
the date night of MCs.
He thinks everybody was on date night.
Would you be honest with us if your name was fake? Because it seems like such a richly musician name. Robbie Fulks, like, I would be like, if somebody said, "Hey, the handyman's coming over to fix the sink, his name is Robbie Fulks," I'd be like, "Well, what the hell's he fixing my sink for? Give that guy a guitar."
Really?
I've
never encountered that point of view, but...
It doesn't sound like a musician's name to you? Well, it wouldn't to you, I guess, if it's your real name, is what you're telling me.
It's my real name, yeah. I wouldn't have chosen it to be a country singer. I don't know what...
Did your mom not like Robert?
So Rob's name is also Robbie.
That was my dad, and yes, you're right.
Is it Robbie on your birth certificate? Robbie?
No, it's Robert.
Oh, okay. Robbie on his birth certificate.
How does that feel?
Robbie Schrab.
Robbie.
Tell him why.
Because my mom, when she was pregnant, there were a lot of restaurants being made, and she thought...
Because his mom's
days.
A Flintstone.
Yeah.
This is back in the Wisconsin restaurant boom.
Yeah.
The outdoors were becoming in.
And then she said... You know, well, one day my son might grow up and he'll own a restaurant.
Not be a hunter-gatherer like we are.
Yeah. He can own a restaurant, and he could call it Robbie's Restaurant. Like, yeah. I couldn't do that if my name was Timothy.
Right. It would be like, if everyone was still foraging, she would have named you Frank.
Yeah. No, nobody would eat at Robert's.
Robert's Restaurant.
And no one named Robert has ever gone by Robbie, so it was really good thinking.
When did you leave the South, Robbie? Not you, Robbie. Robbie Fulks. Robert.
I left it when I was 17, Jeff.
Yeah?
Yeah.
And do you have any connections back there still, or is it...
Oh, yeah, like high school friends that have grown old and hideous looking. Not a lot of people.
Family's all gone?
Not anymore.
No. Yeah, nobody there. My folks moved to Mexico, and yeah, everybody's gone.
I'm not pipping you out to sing this, but there's a song, if you want to listen to it, it's called "That's Where I'm From." It's one of my favorite songs by Robbie. It's a beautiful song about like, you're not country, but you are country because you came from country.
Yeah, me and my wife, we moved to the suburbs, and we got this house that we almost sort of couldn't afford, and I thought, it's a fancy neighborhood for people like us. And then I found out that like all those people came from... you know, Crib Death, Iowa, or somewhere like that, you know, way out.
Crib Death,
the
Iowa.
Name of the town is Crib Death.
Is that why? Because I thought this was so unusual. I've heard that song. Why? It has that bridge by Vincent Price.
Yes.
That's just him That's talking.
Where he talks about sudden infant death syndrome.
Play a couple verses and let's hear the Vincent Price bridge.
Yeah, yeah. When it gets to the...
Oh, yeah, because I forgot the Vincent Price does a kind of a...
You can't do Vincent Price?
Wait, well, no. Do that's where
wait,
I'm from.
Mitch, he's just playing guitar. Well,
the
yeah, but
is loose in the theater.
Whoa, he can do Vincent Price. The Tingler.
Scream for your lives.
He's out there tingling.
Who's singing?
Well,
Dan.
I thought
you were going to play a little bit of That's Where I'm From.
Well, no, Jeff requested this actual song. Sorry, I didn't mean to. And I was just throwing in. I was like, oh, it isn't The Bridge by Vincent Price, which I guess is me saying like, oh, yeah, play that thing that's really valuable to you and means something to you, and I'll fuck it up in the middle.
That's why I'm here. My
famous Vincent Price impression. Well,
if you're going to sing it, Robbie, then give him the boom mic so we can sing into it and not have to hold the thing.
No, I want to hear the Vincent Price impression.
Oh, wait, yeah, no, we got to...
It's
yeah.
too much of me on this show.
No.
All right, well, how about if Vincent Price introduces you and then you do the song?
That's how you do it.
That's what he would do.
That's how you do it.
That's how we do it.
Pretend we're coming back.
We took the time to figure this out because that's how you do it.
Vincent Price is hosting SNL.
Yes.
Ladies and gentlemen. Gentlemen, Robbie Fulks, spooky.
Whoa.
And now give him the mic. Dan, give him the mic so he can sing.
This live television is intense.
So Where's I'm doing the, this maudlin song where, that you
what or, you don't have to do that one, but I love this one. But
you don't
I,
have to do the song.
I adore the song, so if you don't mind.
What did Levy do with the...
What are you doing?
Looking for
the ice bucket?
Fucking life.
Robbie, this is Dito's choice. If you want to sing that one or something else, like, do you want to do another song?
Well, you kind of set it up. So yeah, we'll do it, but
he really did.
Okay. It's kind of maudlin.
Should we do the Vincent Price introduction again?
Yeah, please.
Okay, so Vincent Price introduces it. Robbie sings a couple of verses. There might be a Vincent Price like bridge, like kind of hook. There's Levy with
Steve Levy, we love and appreciate you. Love and appreciate Steve Levy. We appreciate you.
Don't make it unconditional.
We appreciate you, Steve Levy.
Ladies and gentlemen, when I was on tour with the Spiders... we did so much fucking coke that 1,000 ghosts reaped my soul. But this next musician, my heart's not in it.
No, you were nailing it.
His heart wasn't in it. He never.
His heart wasn't in it. Yeah.
It's anyways. The 13 Ghosts of Scooby-Doo presents Robbie Fulks playing. What's the name of the song again?
That's where I'm. From.
Ghost.
Ghost.
Oh, sorry. No, that's where I'm from.
Back in the driveway, the end of the workday, and how fast that world disappears.
Like a ghost.
A fresh lawn, a pine tree. I don't know if I want to do this.
I'm sorry. Start over if you
this
want.
This is what you do. This is what you
I'm
do.
I'm not going to keep doing it. I'm not going to keep doing it.
This is it.
Please.
This is his favorite song, and you're taking a shit
to get
all over
here. A man climbs as high as he can, but his heart belongs where it began. I can see in my mind's eye a shack on a hillside and a mean billy goat on a chain. And Dad doing battle with dirt hard as gravel. In summers, the crops never came. We'd shoot down a pheasant in flight and sing songs about Jesus all night. And that's where I'm from, where time passes slower. That's where I'm from, where it's yes, ma'am, and no, sir. You can't tell I'm country Just you look closer, it's deep in my blood. Two cars, a picket fence, that's where I've come. Dirt roads and double wides, that's where I'm from. Night school on a fast track, and no cause to look back. That place put a scar on my soul. And I swore my young ones would never know hunger. Now the good life is all they know. Well, I've watched them grow, now I see. One thing separates them from me, and that's where I'm from, where time passes slower. That's where I'm from, where it's yes ma'am and no sir. You can't tell I'm country, just you look closer, it's deep in my blood. Two cars, a white collar, a necktie, that's where I've come. Half naked in the moonshine, yeah, that's where I'm from. If you've ever heard Hank Williams sing, brother, you know the whole blessed thing. 'Cause that's where I'm from, where time passes slower. That's where I'm from, where it's yes ma'am and no sir. You can't tell I'm country, just you look closer. Well, it's deep in my blood. A long way down a hard road, that's where I've come. Someplace I can't go home to, that's where I'm from.
Thank you, Robbie.
Oh, wait, Mitch.
I want to take guitar lessons from you. I'm ready. I'm ready. That was beautiful.
Beautiful. You said you're kind of self-taught, too? Like, you started playing by yourself, or did you take lessons as well?
Well, my dad showed me chords and stuff, and my mom, too, and just records after that, you know, I would say.
Whoa. Yeah. Who do you listen to?
Oh, you know, the people that I liked when I was young, you know, I think a lot of them really, I still like them, a lot of them, yeah. Is what I'm trying to say. And that's like Doc Watson and John Hartford, and then later on when I broke from my parents' taste a little bit, you know, the Beatles and obvious stuff like that, I guess.
I don't know that. I mean, I know Doc Watson, obviously, but
yes,
Doc Watson, obviously.
What was the last?
I mean, DeJoy on the Beatles, yeah.
What is where are you at now creatively and or and answer it any way you want, like in your life now, like I don't know what your path has been from youth to and how you've gauged that with like your relationship with other people hearing your music and things. Like where are we finding you right now? Are you pursuing your own bliss at the expense of pleasing other people, or is it the opposite? Are you like, I don't know. It's a bad question, I guess. I'm just always curious with musicians, like you're clearly a very authentic, like confident guy. And I'm wondering, like, have you been on this journey of like, what's your relationship with what you do? Are you, do you go home at night and like putter in a dark room and like play things into a little hard drive and only listen to them yourself and then cut your forearm a little bit? Or would you like another Grammy? Or are you like, is there like a British guy that comes over and goes, Robbie, baby, what are you doing, baby? We need another hit.
It's got to have a hook.
Come on, Bullocks, governor.
I mean, I love where you're from and all that business.
Jesus Christ, give him another fucking syringe for the fucking old-timey country shit. Come on, baby, comfortably numb. Get up. We got a tour to do. Blimey.
That's a great question, Dan.
See, I'm not a bad interviewer. People tell me I'm a bad interviewer.
People say you're a bad interviewer, but that was a perfect question.
I think
question.
I was like, I'm like Charlie Rose, but I was going to say without the sexual harassment, but I'm like Charlie Rose.
You're like Charlie Rose, yeah. You're just like Charlie Rose.
You're exactly Charlie Rose.
I mean, it's a yes or no question. But seriously,
you've moved out to LA with Donna, your wife, and because she's pursuing stuff out here too.
Yeah, I'm tagging along with her, you know. Yeah.
But you gig all the time. You're on tour constantly.
Yeah, I'm out a lot, and I haven't really like found a slot to fit in here yet. But we've only been here a few months, so.
But what was the record that was the Grammy nominee?
Oh, it's Upland Stories. It's about 3 years old, I guess.
And and you also were nominated for a track too, right?
The track was called Alabama at Night. Yeah, I didn't win it. I lost two Grammys. Right. No,
I've technically lost every Grammy.
So you win.
Yeah, so I.
But also, you were up against some cool stuff, but just the fact that somebody found.
I'm a pretty small. I have a real small audience, so it was just cool to be included in that. Yeah.
Yeah, but. I've seen you play, like, when you come to L.A., back when you still were in Chicago, you play McCabe's, which is, like, an awesome music store in,
Santa Monica.
And you're funnier than all the comics that I know, and the music, and you also just pick, like, people that play. I saw you play the Troubadour, and what was that gig that you played the Troubadour? My brother and I came. But the headliner was some, like some young teeny bopper band. Oh, and I texted you
they
afterwards, I was like, those people couldn't follow you because like you and a bunch of kind of old dudes playing like bluegrass killed it. And you texted me back, follow that, motherfuckers, because they couldn't fucking follow it. Because you pick like local musicians and stuff, and everybody just fucking rocks.
So this ends in December, this podcast?
Yeah.
So. Could we have a podcast where you just compliment me, and
yes,
that'll be the whole podcast?
That's our new.
What is that? Here's a more refined question. About I want to know.
Everybody,
if you want to use the restroom,
the exits are.
This is something that I'm curious about with
the
musicians in general, and I'm sure all their answers are different. But I'm just because at the end of the pipeline, we hear songs. They're 2 minutes, 3 minutes, 4 minutes. They have titles. All right.
6 minutes. 7 minutes.
Ha, ha,
8 minutes.
8 minutes.
Nine minutes.
I'm curious about the process of like the relationship with like what the end product is. Like, does a musician or you yourself, like, what do you, is it like, ah, God.
Just ask a question. Ask him a question.
I think what just... Dan is asking. No, I think what it. I will say, like my friend Jim Valley always says, talent is the thing you can't do. And so, like, I'm speaking for Dan here, but like for me, like I listen to that, it boggles my mind. I don't know how you could do it. I don't know how you could write it.
Well, that's why I wonder, like, how do you define, like, when something becomes a song? Like, do you go? Are you like sitting in bed and you're watching Succession on HBO, and then you're like,
very good thing.
Fuck, I got a song in my, I gotta go down.
Yeah. I only got 2 hours left to finish this song.
Jeff's acting like if I stop asking the question, you're gonna have boom, just a fountain of information.
Ask a question.
Yeah, I'm working on it, okay. Man.
Here's my question. I got a question for you. Because your work has got to be so self-motivated, you know, and like I've sort of even chosen TV because you have, yeah. Wait, is that modern dance?
Oh shit, Dan's having a heart attack.
What is he doing? What is going on?
He's having a stroke.
What the fucking...
No, I think I know. I think I know what Dan is asking.
I can't believe.
But so I've chosen a field where there's always a gun to my head. Always a deadline. Seriously, and do you don't have that?
Answer the question, Robbie.
How often do you write songs? How often do you write songs?
That's
how
a question.
How often do you write songs, you piece of shit?
Robbie, Write a song, Robbie. Write a song.
Okay. Well,
No.
Look what you did. That's you.
I'm out of here.
That's a Harmontown second.
Yeah.
Not often enough. He did leave his phone, though.
Yeah.
Oh, good.
There's a good chance Tina Fey's numbers.
That's a good bit, then.
He left. He actually left.
But that's it's hard to question somebody out of the room. I mean, pros.
Did he really leave?
I hope. No, I'm kidding.
Yeah,
I wouldn't want to be subjected to that.
Yeah, a culture was created during the question of like.
Yeah. Robbie, come back.
It's hard to explain to the listener what Dan did. In that moment,
it was almost like
a man dancing a with a strobe light over him.
I know what it is.
We saw moments of poses, and emotions were definitely coming through. It's very emotional.
It's what the evil teacher does in Fairly Odd Parents when he says fairy godparents.
Yeah, it had some of that.
I haven't seen that.
He does these poses. Various ones.
All right, so.
But I think you should continue. Go ahead, continue the question. I mean, because why not? Why not finish the question?
I mean, well, no, I'm just curious.
What difference?
Like, this is what
this
I want to know from musicians all the time. Is like, how does the, like. How does the brick that is a song, like, how does it get generated? Jeff. Like, does it.
What do you mean by the break? Like, when does he know he's done, or does he know he's onto something?
Do they generate music by the yard, and then do they, like, cut here and there and go, like, okay, there's a song,
or do
they, like, generate it in a pile, or delivering a song
music.
Like a baby? Like, it's like 3 minutes of,
Well, if I can answer for Robbie, I think...
You're going to have to.
I do think there's a difference between playing music and writing music, because it takes 3 minutes to play 3 minutes of music.
Right. Okay. You know I follow
mean? You. Right. Whereas what we do usually takes a lot longer.
Right.
It's like improv. You know how long it takes to make 6 minutes of improv. 6 minutes.
Right.
But writing a song is a whole different thing. I mean, do you wait for inspiration? Or?
But do you? Yeah. Exactly. Ask
him that if he comes back.
I want to like.
That's a great question. Do you wait for inspiration, or do you just approach it like, okay, I'm going to see what comes out of me?
Yeah. I know, it's a great question.
God, I wonder what the answer is.
Rob, why do you look so pissed?
What's that?
Rob looks very pissed.
No, I'm just, this fucking chair sucks.
Oh, okay.
Hurts if you sit here long enough. Right? Right? Sorry. I'm sorry, what?
There's no back support, he said.
There's no back support. Oh, okay, cool.
All right, so if I don't, so like we will, we're making a renewed vow to work on our joint project.
Yeah, I think it's a great idea. I have an idea for it.
You have an idea for it?
Well, not an idea.
Let's
but I
hear
mean,
it.
I don't have an idea for it. No, I my idea is to make it a period piece, which I'll talk to you about.
Like 80s?
No, like menstruation. Like
whoa. That could be good.
Yeah, no. Like 80s or. Did you? What was the first show you worked on? It was your own show, right?
Yeah.
It was, right? You didn't ever did multicam. Or
I never.
You, didn't do that kind
of thing. Worked on the Golden Girls. That was your.
I did.
Which I started binging, and it was like it's such an amazing like.
It was a good learning experience.
Did we talk about when you were on the show? Did we have the conversation where it was like how needless it was that Sophia was originally portrayed as like having had a stroke, and that right. That's the justification for why she was so flinty.
Didn't we talk about that? But that was the justification.
There was so much energy put into like, but your mom,
your mother. Look, she had a stroke. It destroyed the part of her brain that censors her speech.
So she that was so the concept. She's a really old lady that just says whatever she wants, as if that like, needed a medical justification.
Like, the one character you're explaining the personality of, as opposed to like, and then B. Arthur's character. Well, you know, her singular. Occipital lobes
right.
Fire in conjunction with her amygdala.
Ovaries she's are in a withered nasty. But tingling, yeah, no, generating an extra estrogen,
she's creating
estrogen dripping down her
at
labia.
At an enormous rate.
Yeah. Well, hey, you agree then it would be a bad idea.
Every personality explained through chemistry.
Every Golden Girl.
Yeah. Yeah,
why
no, that was, that
looking?
Was, although I will say at the time it was not cool show to be. It was great to be on that show. It was an amazing learning experience, and they
which
were
season
such
were
pros.
You
but
on?
I guess I started at the end of season 4. No, end of season 5, and then I was on it through the end.
Because in binging it, it seems like I felt like you could feel the
show get worse.
No,
yeah, because it kind of. I mean, it did. You know what happens is you start using the tricks of the trade.
Well, there was what I felt like I perceived was a really solid first season that was undoubtedly probably a show that people probably didn't put a lot behind.
Well, and that Susan Harris created, and she was and is a genius.
And it was like it just ran like this
Sam
little
Harris's
moped
mom,
that was like so
way.
Efficient. And then you could sense in the beginning of the second season premiere began with like the fucking ferrets in the cages in the garage or whatever. And it was as if like the floodgates had opened and like, all right, congratulations, you got season 2. Now here's the thing. We got so-and-so coming in. He used to showrun.
No, actually, that was not the case. I think it was, believe it or not, it was like it premiered at number 1. It was just one of those weird things. Nobody had programmed to older people, and nobody had programmed successfully on Saturday night, I guess since like Mary Tyler Moore or something. And it became number 1 in the country. It was a huge thing. Although it wasn't a hip show. So I didn't walk off of there with like a great, like the guys who were on Cheers and that kind of
right.
thing. But it was incredible. And even just being able to see, you know, these 4 amazing actresses naked was...
I know. That was back when you were allowed to just like...
Oh my God, you were expected to.
Yeah. It was their duty.
It was a show of respect.
But what was the tone like on set? Was it season 4? Like, was there... They were,
I think
if you make
5.
It to season 4, you're allowed for. I think the actors are allowed to actually all hate each other. And but
I don't think. I mean, I think Betty, you know, played to the crowd and everything. And B was, you know, they didn't get along great. They were opposite. I always thought they were opposites in the sense that B was kind of scary on the outside, but so sweet on the inside. And you know, Betty is so sweet on the outside and. A little scary on
the She fucking put Chevy's nuts in a vice when she was on Community.
Oh,
like,
really?
I don't really have like a wonderful anecdote about that, but it was like it was more. Honestly, it's more credit to Chevy because I think Chevy like it was more about him respecting her so much that it was very easy for her to kind of wither him.
Yeah.
It was something like she just met him and she was like she said something like I've heard about you. And but that's okay, or something. Just some bit that was sort of like, and he was like, "What?" Whoa. And everyone was like laughing at him, and you could see him be like, "God damn."
Yeah,
Betty
that
White.
Sounds like her. She was very direct, and yet, you know, because she's sort of fearless, And she, yeah, that was always, you know, also B. Arthur had to do all her scenes with Estelle. Estelle had memory problems, which we later found out was deeper than that. And so B would have to do her scenes 20, 30 times. Jeez. So she was just in a bad mood, yeah. You know? And also there was, well, I'm not going to tell that story.
That's fair. Could you make up a different story?
Yes.
Okay.
No, there. That's. I'll tell everybody off the air. but no, it was. I remember when I met Betty. I had said, "Oh, they want me to tell you they're doing a layout upstairs." And she said, "Oh yes, and someone took pictures." And I just looked at her confused. You know what I mean? She was saucy. She was always being, yeah, there's a layout. Like, you know, I was fucking upstairs, was, I think, her point of view on that joke. Yeah. Yeah, she told it much better. but that's amazing that you did not have to go through that, because that was a great experience, but a lot of the other shows I was on was not. I mean, you know, you're not doing your voice.
Yeah. I suffered for that entirely. That's the thing, is like, if I could do it all over again, I spent so many years like just writing kind of in vain. I guess it's easy to say because I know now that all the things that I wrote in between, you know, it's like they didn't go anywhere anyway, so I may as well have been in someone else's writer's room. But it, God damn, I suffered as a showrunner because I went from, I was an officer and I was never an enlisted man.
Right. Well, that's true. But I think when you have a strong point of view, it's showrunning is a whole other thing. I mean, it really is. It's like being a chef and then someone saying, okay, now we've got 100 of these to make.
Right.
And,
but understanding that if you have 10 people that cost a total of $1 million of the studio's money and they're there to help you and that you can't actually offend them by saying, for instance, I think we can beat this joke. Just things that I had to learn slowly that had I come up as a staff writer, I could have been like on point season one and been
like, I mean, possibly I would say like the best thing for people who want to write and that kind of thing, you know, it's going to sound counterintuitive, but I do think when you're in those jobs and you're coming up, it's, you want to be of service, you want to be of support, you know? And I think it is a bad impulse, even though I had it, to say, well, when do I get my voice out there? When do I do my thing? I do think the experiences support someone.
Yeah.
And it does give you a different perspective when you're in that job. And sometimes not a better perspective because you're upset when people aren't supporting you. But that's the skill set.
Yeah, you don't, well, there's your primary instinct is, what kind of hack would I be if I told another writer that what they had written for me was not good enough for me? All of your training as a supposedly amazing writer tells you that's what a shitty writer would do. Like, you don't tell another writer.
It's uncomfortable when you're working in a creative field and there's a lot of people working together. It's hard to be direct about that stuff. And so, someone recently said to me, I was in a room and I said, oh, that's funny, when somebody pitched something, and another writer said, that means it's not funny. That's what Mitch says. And I realized it's true. I've just done that for so long. Yeah. Like, oh, that's funny. And then hope this conversation changes and something actually funny.
And then I go, no wrong answers.
Yeah, no wrong answers. Wrong answers.
Wait a minute.
Yeah, when wolf.
Come on.
All right, the people when have spoken. Wolf. But it's just interesting to me that that could be a form of selfishness when you believe that you're doing how much not communicating with other people, like, you think you can think that makes you non-abusive, for instance,
if you're being direct is better, being honest is better, although it doesn't feel like it.
If you're like, if you close your office door and are just like, I'll just do it, and they're like, you close the office door, it's like, that's a form of abuse to a like person that's like, but I don't know what I did wrong.
The other revelation of that kind of job, and I know a lot of people here are pursuing that kind of career, is that you're working your way up, you're trying to find your thing, you're trying to be funnier if you're in comedy, you're trying to get your pilot made and that kind of thing, and then finally you do, and you've got all these employees, and you just have no preparation to have people work for you. It's just not part of what you've been planning. You haven't been thinking, I'm going to be a manager of people, I'm going to worry about their time off, I'm going to make sure that their feelings are okay. It's just not there. And
oh, and by the way, I can't wait to read all their shit, because that's why I became a writer. I love reading.
Yeah, and you have to kind of make the shift that it's, I mean, it sounds corny, but that it's a privilege. Like, you have to realize you know, and it took me a while to realize, yeah, like, this is a real benefit that I get to have people that count on me.
They're happier.
But at first, it's an imposition.
Would you put a shock collar on your dog?
No.
Do you know that a shock collar?
On what part of my dog?
Like a...
Because they're parts that would be funnier.
You know, they make those vibration and sound collars?
Well, no. Are you what behavior are you trying to modify?
Barking.
No, you're just going to terrorize your dog. You're not going to teach the dog to not bark. You're just going to terrorize.
That's not what the Amazon reviews say.
That's not what
well,
the
there
Amazon
you go. Is. Then fucking do whatever you want.
I think you're supposed to praise them when they're not barking. So just constantly praise them.
That is.
And then when they bark, just be quiet.
Harvey, I think be the
shit. I think a lot of people's dogs do.
Yeah.
That's one of the main things that dogs do.
When they're not just hanging out being dogs, they're barking.
Right.
Yeah.
Harvey seems to be, I think that the new house being bigger and empty, I think he's barking more and more.
And it's almost like how we've talked more since Robbie left.
Right.
And they've talked for
well, you think about it, like the dog is doing you a favor. It's got a bigger space to protect. So well, anytime
good,
it sees anything
nice
that
point.
Is foreign or dangerous.
Oh, shit.
It's alerting it, so.
They love this point you're making.
Yeah.
They love this point you're making. Yeah. You're right. It is. It's he's protecting the family.
Yeah.
Robbie and I just made love in the green room.
What?
You forgot your phone.
Oh.
Tina called.
Yeah. She does not appreciate the dick pic that Rob sent.
Dan, do you know any country songs that you can sing? Or any folk songs? I mean, we have an opportunity here for, like, you can sing whatever you want.
Oh, my God.
This guy, he's still in here?
Yeah.
Country songs, like existing country songs?
Or it could be any song. Also, hilariously, probably the sales might have been down on this, but Robbie made it, like, how many years ago did you make the Michael Jackson cover album?
Oh, geez.
What? What? You made a Michael Jackson cover album?
It's all covers, and your version of Man in the Mirror is fucking outrageous. It's really good, but now probably not so big on the charts.
Well, it's good to take it from him, you know? It's like, let's do different versions of all this stuff, and then we could disassociate it with Michael Jackson. That could be good.
Go out and check it out. What's the record called?
It's called Happy. It is.
Are you a Willie Nelson fan?
Sure, yeah.
I mean, who would say no? No, fuck Willie Nelson.
Yeah. Hate
but,
him.
Like, Willie Nelson reminds me of my parents getting along. Like, it was like... like when they weren't fighting, they would put on a Willie Nelson album, and then you know Southern Comfort on the Rocks and a fireplace going, and it was like Willie Nelson. So, I guess those are the only country songs that I like.
Which one do you think you know some of the words?
Blue Eyes Crying in the Rain.
I know some. Well, are you pushing for that because you're like your fingers are can't wait to. Because I I don't.
Mama, don't your babies?
I'm like, there's the two cowboy ones. I think it's like the two that are the urban cowboy right now, Electric Horseman soundtrack. Robert Redford and Jane Fonda.
That's Campbell.
Mamas, don't let your babies grow up to be cowboys. And then what's the other one that's cowboys?
Is like, Luckenbach on there or no?
I don't know. I think it's like a whole Willie Nelson soundtrack, like
Redhead Stranger is on there.
But there's what's the other cowboy Willie Nelson song where it's like there's another one that's like cowboys fucking what'd you say?
Poncho and Lefty?
No. I feel like it's like almost like you hear the titles and you're kind of like, didn't you already do that song? It's like one's like Mamas don't let your God damn it, and there's another one that's like cowboys do this or that and they don't do that and
The Cowboy Rulebook?
Yeah, I think that's what it is. The Cowboy Rulebook.
Yeah, might be that.
Why don't we write the Cowboy Rulebook song right now?
All right, okay.
All out Willie Nelson.
Nelson brings you the Cowboy Rulebook.
These are the rules of the cowboy.
Cowboys never wear blue jeans.
Whoa.
After Labor Day, when there's rattlesnakes born,
Cowboys never drink whiskey outside a saloon with no Wi-Fi. Cause they never want any forlornness. These are the rules for cowboys. These are the rules. Cause they have every cowboy.
Always.
Yeah.
Never
has the rules. Yeah, no, you got the idea. Cowboys are always riding around with a horsey. If two cowboys meet, the one on the left has to dance. That's not the end.
Oh.
If three cowboys join up in a market, they have to have a quorum. If there's 11 cowboys or less, there can only be three pants. Any carpet a cowboy walks on is now magic. That means it can lift up to four cowboys in its weight. If you go to a restaurant with DJ's more than seven or cowboys, you have to give the cowboy to your right half your plate.
Okay.
Cowboys, these are the rules. These are the cowboy rules. These are the rules the cowboys have to follow. Boys, when the cowboys come home, they got a rule book.
The rule book.
But cowboys always follow.
I think that's the. I hope Willie Nelson doesn't hear that, because he'll think I was doing Harrison Ford or David Duchovny.
So when you write a song like that, Dan, is it?
Dan,
do you?
What's your process, Dan? When you're a musician you ever, and you're writing a song
can
like
a,
that,
can a,
first I'll hear something in the shower, like, and sure. I'm like, yeah. Is the radio on? And then they'll be like, no, that's my heart.
Wait, for God. Real though, Robbie. Yeah.
Like, that means you're the real deal.
Country good. Music, especially, and not just country, but like pop music too. But country, like a lot of songs are like, oh, I found a great title of a song, and I'm gonna write the song around that title. Yeah. Like, do you ever do that? Like, do you think of like, oh, that should be a song, that phrase that I heard, I just thought of or heard.
Like Schitt's Creek.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, that's. I think that's the that. Yeah, that's the country way. You start with a hook, with a title, and right. kind of work around that.
That's just like TV writing in a way.
Is it?
Arrested Development. Right.
I want this episode to be called An Evening to Remember.
Well, that was often like an NBC mid-season show kind of yeah. thing. It was you could expect like six shows that yeah. were like swipe to the left. They're like, okay, that's six right. an hour.
Yes, the hip show.
Yeah, it was always like yeah. sexting.
OMG.
But you can't complain about them because you never know which one of those is going to be like, because there's always something on the air that's like, 83 reasons my daughter's my uncle in the future. And they're like, how did that, what? They didn't expect that to go more than 11. They're it's like, yeah, here we are. Yeah,
we have no backup plan.
There's no wrong answers in TV.
Do you,
here's my real songwriting question.
Do you give yourself an assignment or do you just wait to see what comes to you? Will you say, like, all right, this weekend I really want to at least put something down?
Well, to be honest, I don't like writing that well. It's not fun, you know?
Same page.
I'll wait for a reason,
yeah.
you know?
With you. I know, yeah. yeah.
What do you think?
But you don't have, you have to make your own reason. In television, you don't have to. You have a, you know, you got a deadline, but...
Well, maybe once in a while somebody will throw me a project or something. But, yeah, usually it's like, oh, it's time to do another record, you know? So then you got to write the record.
Hard. It's hard.
I got a project for you, Robbie Fulks. It's an app called Chordbot. I use it to make my own songs while I work out. And you can hit this button, and it goes song-o-matic, and it gives you a four... What are they called? Measures? You're like, what is what called?
Bars?
Bars is probably what it is. And then you hit the thing, and then it goes like... That's C major, F major.
Those are great chords.
E flat.
I'm a big
major,
C major fan.
A minor.
I love it.
C major. What do you think about that? Are you scared like John Henry was
Mama,
with the steam engine?
Don't let your babies grow up to be cowboys.
You're a little scared, aren't you?
Yeah, it's like the steam
You're like,
engine.
Oh, there's a real little Robbie Fulks in my phone. Yeah. You're like, what's happening? Yeah. What is this witchcraft?
Was it Robbie play it? C to what?
This is because you can have this. The phone doesn't own this. It made it up. That's two. Three. C. F.
I tell you, it really seems to work. It's a great song.
No, you're not helping, Rob. That's not helping. Robbie was like, why is that? That's vandalism. What you're doing, you're like distracting him. You're like 4chan. Then you're the 4chan of this song.
Wait, yeah. I want to see you.
What?
Keep going, Dan. Dan, Rob, Robbie, keep going.
No, not
Rob Schrab.
Yeah,
Rob, you're on probation.
But that's the real world. When you write a song, there's always someone who's trying to get in there and ruin it for you. It prepares you for that.
Yeah, that's what I do.
Yeah, there's always going to be a counter.
I was about to create a song with a legendary songwriter.
The song, Robbie, your song "Fuck This Town," is that based on an actual like autobiography of being in Nashville?
Yeah, it is, Jeff. "Fuck This Town." We were. We're driving along, and like people always say town in Nashville, like it's kind of a folksy saying. It's a city, you know, they're always saying this town. And we're driving along, a bunch of songwriters, and in the 90s or whatever, somebody goes, it's a 5-year town, Nashville. We got to be patient, it's a 5-year town. And somebody goes, well, the town is really. And I was in the back, and I said, like, hey, fuck this town, you know?
It's a
and
fucking
I thought, hey,
good
that's a good song title.
It is.
Yeah.
Wait, was it fuck it in the end, fuck it up and down?
No, fuck it end to end.
Fuck it end to end.
Yeah, yeah.
And fuck it up and down.
Up and down.
That's very punk rock. So what is the, given that the attitude
but
of
I
that.
Guess, but it, sometimes you do have to get angry.
Well, that's,
you know what I mean?
That's
true. I mean, I really
that's
like,
a question I have about country western is like, what are the things that demarcate? Because there's been controversies lately where it's like a hip hop guy, like the content of his rap was like him riding on a horse or whatever. And then they were like, oh, that's not eligible for whatever. And it's like, what is the, I'm assuming the answer is it's not definitive, but like in your mind, what makes the difference between the genres of music? Like what is country western that separates it? Is it about musical?
Like seriously?
Yeah. Like, is it an engineering answer?
Yeah. What is the definition of country western? No, I agree. Like it. Obviously, we hear it. You can tell.
I thought
you
were mocking
it, but
my question, so that's why I laughed.
Yeah.
So I'll tell you what I think. I think I'm a little bit divorced from what's been going on in country music for the last 35 years. I'm not real up on it, but I think it's like still connected to what it was in the sense that it's kitchen sink songs. It's like universal subjects. It's like, you know, it's like microscoped down to the level of the family and the you know, a couple individuals in a house trying to get along, things like that. And I think it does that better than stories about that. In simple language, better than any other genre, maybe.
A song of yours, like you have a lot of upbeat, happy songs, but you've got some very, like, really lonely, sad songs, like "Forgotten."
And it's about great singing. Excuse me.
Yeah, I don't
say that. Fucking, yes, everybody in country music.
You have a fucking
great
range.
Fucking
like you can sing real high, and like you got a big ass range.
You can't hide your voice. There's nowhere to, you know, you're
right
front
out and
there.
Center. Yeah.
But there's a song like for listeners to go check out as "Forgotten But Not Gone." That song is sad as fuck, but I love it. It's really like lonesome and great.
Thank you. This podcast needs more compliments, though.
But
You also need to be kept humble with a run for your money from the algorithm.
Oh, here we go.
Because listen to this, Robbie.
By algorithm.
I can add a guitar to this. Hold on. Acoustic guitar. Uh-oh. Rob, stop it.
No, Rob.
Robbie Fulks, I'm the algorithm. I've come to take your soul to hell. You believe that your music will save you, but I have a different tale to tell. I was born on Golgotha, next to Christ, with bones in my femurs. That's where everyone has bones. Big deal. My name is Beelzebub!
So that wouldn't be a country song.
No.
Like, as an example.
Robbie,
because it doesn't have that down to earth.
Robbie, what key is Ramblin' Fever in? Is that the same key?
You know, Jeff, we were doing it in E back there during the hiatus.
If you know it, you all know Merle Haggard. Nope, one person went, who?
What is Merle Haggard?
Oh, Merle Haggard. Yeah, he's dead. It's a song called Ramblin' Fever.
And is it okay if Mitch and I go into the green room and speak really loudly about Golden Girls for the next 10 minutes?
Well, that way the audience gets
with
it
no
all.
Explanation?
They get everything.
Or
they get
should we
all
deploy?
At the same time. It's like okay. A big, it's but like also, the climax.
Dan,
of the...
there might be a Vincent Price like middle section in this.
Yeah.
My hat don't hang on the same nail too long. It's just me or you.
Oh, you go.
My ears can't stand to hear the same old song. And I don't stay on one road long enough to bog down in the mud. 'Cause I've got ramblin' fever in my blood, Jeff B. Davis.
I caught this ramblin' fever long ago. When I first heard a lonesome whistle blow, if someone ever said I gave a damn, well, they damn sure told you wrong. I've had a rambling fever all along.
Everyone join in.
Everyone
except that one guy.
Fever.
kind of can't
be measured one by degrees. Ramblin' fever. There ain't no kind of cure for my disease. But there's times I'd like to bed down on a sofa and let some pretty lady rub my back and spend the early morning drinking coffee, dreaming about when I'll be coming back. Take it, Robbie.
Yeah! Tie me down, and I'll never get too old to get around. I wanna die beside the highway and rot away like some old highline pole, and rest this rambling fever in my soul. All right, sing, you motherfuckers. Rambling fever. Kind that can't be measured by degrees. Ramblin' fever. Ramblin' fever. Ain't no kind of cure for my disease.
Ain't no kind of cure for my disease.
One more chorus. Ramblin' fever. The kind that can't be measured by degrees.
Thank you all for coming to Harmontown, everybody. Let's give it up for Mitch Hurwitz. Rob Schrab. I'm Jeff Davis. Give it up for Robbie Fulks, everybody. Spencer Crittenden, Dan Harmon is your mayor. Thank you so much. Zach, put a beat on. Thank you all. Drive fast and take chances. Thank you so much for coming down.
Watch Creep Show this Thursday.
Watch Creep Show.
This Thursday.
This
Creep
Thursday.
Show. My episode is
on Shudder.
Check it out. Only reason I showed up tonight was to promote that. Glad I got it in there.
Get any of that?
It's a good show.